So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Again, really nice to see you all. We carry on. There's even more today. This session, as previous first sessions, is mainly focused on meditation practice with a bit of input before. So we'll follow that pattern. This morning, this afternoon, or this evening, I'd like to focus on the first stage of the metta bhavana, the first stage of the metta bhavana, where we bring kindness to ourselves. And I want to give a little bit of input on it. It's partly sharing what's been really helpful for me in this stage. So I'm just kind of like to put it out there, and it's really helped me reframe the way I relate to bringing kindness or metta to what we call kind of self, you know, here. And it is an odd stage in a way, the first stage, isn't it? Because it's like you're here and you're kind of bringing kindness to yourself. But you know, in a sense, you know, what is the self? In a way, it immediately kind of opens up that kind of question for me. And in a way, as we've been exploring so far in this retreat, the self is quite multifaceted. It's very, very conditional, you know, very, very responsive to conditions and such, and can keep changing kind of shape and color and form, and is constantly evolving and unfolding, and has a deep mystery at its root. A while ago, I was on an event, and someone was saying about how they spent an evening in a van. They were sleeping in a van. And they could hear this kind of banging sound outside, you know, in the night. And at a kind of adult conscious level, the person knew that it was just like horses, you know, knocking against something in the neighboring field. But on a bodily level, their system was feeling very anxious, even panicky. You know, it was seeing some kind of threat in the sound. And we've often got these this kind of like poles apart in our consciousness, haven't we? Where, you know, on one level we're seeing it one way, and then on another level that's also very real, it's being experienced in a very different way, you know. So for this person, you know, the heart might be racing, they might be kind of tensing up, getting very restless, whilst at the same time, something in them feeling I'm completely overreacting here. You know, there's no actual threat kind of thing. But what I wanted to focus on was another kind of poles apart that can so often come up for us as humans. And recently I was on another retreat, and I've been in different group settings with people kind of reporting in. And one thing that was really striking me was how many people were talking about not liking themselves. You know, full of kind of self-doubt and feeling not good enough, you know, feelings of shame, kind of difficulty kind of saying what they were feeling, and things like this. And I came away from that and I thought, oh, you know, be interesting to kind of bring more attention to that in terms of the first stage of the metta bhavana, you know, this kind of judging ourselves as bad or faulty, or inadequate and such. A couple of days ago, I used the image of the brick and the kite. So this again, I do have this tendency of being much more interested in the brick than in flying the kite. But I trust, that as we work through the brick, the kite naturally wants to fly. I mean, other people have different attitudes to practice. My interest is often is focusing on getting curious about the brick. So for me, one thing that was really changed here was the framing of adult consciousness and child consciousness. That we have these poles in us. There's an adult that has, all the qualities that come from, our life experience and all the capacities of different parts of our brain. All the learning and practice we've done, and so on. And then there's child consciousness. So I just wanted to say a little bit about this. It's just a little background to this reframing. Hopefully, it will kind of come together and make sense at the end. So as youngsters, we're very, very, very highly sensitive. We feel things very strongly, and we're very dependent on the care in the environment, And if the care in the environment falls short, that can easily spark strong feelings of fear, grief, helplessness, anger. We know now little ones are wired to protest if their needs aren't met, so that fires up autonomically. Kids are wired to protest to the environment to communicate their needs if their needs aren't met. And so if there is lack in the environment from the primary caregivers, from the actual literal physical environment that the kid's in, this kind of intense emotion can easily get too much for an emerging nervous system. And it gets kind of somaticized, the energy, the psychic energy gets frozen in time. The body is trying to keep itself regulated, so the intensity of the emotion isn't sustainable. So the system kind of compartmentalizes it. Well, there's a splitting, that's the traditional term here. And there's been studies that have been done at even like the mother's gaze, even if the mother's gaze isn't attuned, that can be a really triggering thing for the little infant. I don't know what's going to be happening in some years with mobile phone use and things, but that the infant's very much dependent on being seen with kindly eyes, And it seems like the more there's too much for us as kids, there's more childhood consciousness in the system, and some people's nervous systems have more resilience than others. But and so we end up with this kind of gulf. There's a child consciousness that can get triggered, and then there's an adult consciousness that is, it seems, in a very different kind of space. And so to varying degrees, we have this inheritance. So my question here is, what does deeds of loving kindness mean here? With deeds of loving kindness, I purify my body. So in a way, what does that mean here? One thing is, I think it feels like a key thing is, well, certainly for me, and I was a long, long way into practice really before this started to come into view, was to know child consciousness as such, to be able to recognize that, particularly at a body level, how it shows up. And I think as body awareness deepens, then it's more like we're moving to what's been frozen in us and split off, you know? And I know, you know, many of you are well down this path of kind of reuniting, reintegrating, you know, what's been kind of left behind. So I thought what I know this is quite an elaborate introduction to working with one aspect of the first stage of the metta bhavana, but what I thought I'd do is I'd just briefly share some characteristic signs of childhood consciousness, you know, that might help us come more into relationship. This first one's possibly the key one, and it does need enough body connection, is that as we're with ourselves, we start to get the sense that there's something in us that feels young, you know, or feels small, or feels young and small. You know, we start to get a kind of felt emotional sense that this feels young, or this feels small, or little. And then there's often the actual kind of consciousness tendencies at this age. So there's more and more known now about how a child sees the world, you know, and there's some core characteristics, you know. So one of them is black and white thinking. So the little infants can't hold complexity or nuance. So it's very easy for things like I'm good, or I'm bad, or I'm stupid. You know, it's very global judgments, but quite stressful, very stressful to believe in, you know, very crude pigeonholes, you know, that we place ourselves in. And then there's a strong tendency to like have this prone to blaming self, you know, making self bad. So this phrase I came across that has stayed with me is a kid can't be a good kid in a bad situation. No. It's too scary for a little kid to think there's something wrong with the parents, because their whole wiring is to be completely dependent on the parent to keep them alive. So they tend to kind of, I feel bad, therefore I am bad. You know, there's this identification happens. Because I'm feeling bad, that means I am bad, you know? So they've got the real roots of shame and lack of self-worth here, really. It makes sense at the time, but it's very limiting if we don't grow out, to the degree we don't kind of grow out of that. And of course, there's very little sense of agency, you know, at this young age. There's very little sense of like, that's what I need to do, or, you know, I can do this. There's a strong sense of I can't, and I need another to rescue or to do something for me, you know. Easily overwhelmed, very limited capacity to tolerate emotion, and that can easily go into feeling panicky. And a really strong fear of sometimes of getting things wrong, because the stakes can feel much higher through a child's eyes when they're young of getting something wrong, because if there's a sense of being turned away from or rejected, that can have associations of isolation and even death. So, you know, this area can be very charged, you know. And then, I mean, I'm just skipping through this, but the final one, just touching on like very early impacts, is around like pre-verbal. So this is a big area, is what's sometimes called a nameless dread. You know, there's this real fear or dread of something, but it has no words to it, although it can project onto things in our current life, you know. So, and of course, you know, sometimes when we're triggered, this gets the upper hand in us, you know, as adults. So some of that black and white thinking might come out with our partners or family, you know, like you never pay attention to me. It's a very stressful belief, isn't it? You never pay attention to me. Or maybe we're very demanding and don't see the other person, it's black and white thinking, or we're focused on pleasing and don't see our own needs. You know, it's often these poles that childhood consciousness kind of fits into. And then as an adult, I mean, this happens ever such a lot, where it's so easy for us to then attack ourselves for being like this. You know, I don't know why I just can't do this, or what's wrong with me? I'm stupid, I can't say what I want. You know, you know, I want to confess and go beyond this, you know. So in a way, what that for me has the flavor of is more kind of the poisons, really. You know, it's aversion, it's a strong response of aversion, or ignoring, you know, a part of us. And so I just wanted to just give a couple, just put out a couple of ideas here about how we might want or could practice with this in a way that might reach these young parts in us, you know. You know, so for in Buddhism, everything is conditioned. So this is arising in dependence upon conditions. And there's a potential here to you get curious about what's going on, you know, what might be driving this. So again, it's like dialing up the curiosity, turning towards what, you know, in a sense, what am I holding on to here that's giving rise to this? And how am I habitually with it? You know, what are my patterns? If I notice any of those characteristics and others, you know, how am I habitually with it? So what I was wondering if we could do now is just a little, I've got like a bit of a throat chest infection, so my voice is a bit Dalek-y this session. What I'd like us to do is just a little thing on the chat. So if there's and many of you will have way more experience of this than me. If there's a little upset child that's feeling distressed and overwhelmed, what in your experience helps bring safety and a shift in that little child's state of being? You know, what have you found that's effective in that? And maybe here a young child, like between like 0 and 4 years old. Yeah, so thanks, Ali. Physical touch, a hug. Soft words. Physical contact. Loving gaze. Thank you, Sarvantu. Presence. Gentle singing. Smiles and kindness. Knowing that it's not my fault to feel this way. Sitting alongside, repeating back to them what they're expressing so they feel heard. Oh my goodness, I'm getting stay near and calm, soft and stroke, any of those. Thank you, Chittamodini. Being heard and seen. Thank you, Alan. Warmth, temperature and acknowledgement. So there was a little run on it there. Staying near and calm, soft stroke at the distal edges, getting out of the room I'm into, get outside and be with people in nature, whatever feels right. Yeah. Repeating back to them what they are expressing so they feel heard, sitting alongside warmth and temperature. So see how easy that just springs out of us, you know, grounding my heart in my guts. Yeah. Saying yes, affirming. Yeah. God, yeah. Saying yes, affirming. practice love. Patient love. Thank you, Krishna Jyoti, yeah. Right, so I'm gonna gallop on. I'm not gonna leave time for the practice. Genuine interest. So that's really good, isn't it? The nervous system picks up whether it's genuine or not. So yeah, really lovely nuance, subtlety there. So there's an element potentially here is reparenting. You know, can the adult in me come down and meet these parts with touch, with a loving, patient gaze, with kindness, with affirmation, with curiosity, with witnessing, being there. Thanks, Boog. With sitting beside, all these things you've mentioned, you know. Being with this energy just as it is, without judgment. You know, it's probably had enough judgment. Self-touch. Yeah. So there's a lot of comments coming through here. I think I'll be in comfortable with myself. I think I'll harvest these and I'll post them on the site. So I do. There's one thing I want to finish with here, and this is one thing that's really been striking. I think God, is Buddhist practice really in a way this kind of, you know, straightforward in a way. You know, it's not complex conceptually. My voice is really going actually. Pranya paramita. The great mother, you know, the perfection of wisdom. Isn't that amazing that the mother of all Buddhas, sometimes called, is called the great mother, you know. And my sense is that the traditional depiction of, you know, Buddha meeting Mara, like quite a lot of the Nagas and things, you know, is relating to this area. You know, that we can see them as, you know, really scary parts of ourselves or places we don't want to go to or be near. But the Buddha sort of saw through that, you know, and then they fell as kind of petals and things. So is it possible to love these parts back into their underlying nature of spacious awareness? The Buddha talked about knotted parts of us. Is it possible for us to love these places out of their knots and things? And the reason why I've given quite a lot of time to this is my sense is that the charge at this level for many of us is so strong that it's driving a lot of our hindrances in meditation. You know, a lot of our anxiety and restlessness, a lot of our sloth and torpor, a lot of our doubt about practice. A lot of our lot fantasying about being somewhere else, sense desire, is driven by this radiating sense of unease or something not right or not at peace in us deep down, you know. So I think this is a deep way of working on ethics as well, you know. Slowly, gradually turning towards and trying to build trust both ways. The little one needs to learn to trust us, and we need to learn to trust the little one. You know, so little steps and the middle way. You know, it's very easy in this area to get swept away into becoming, regressing into the little one, and it's very easy for us to just kind of push the little one out the door, you know. So that's a little talk. It just bubbled up this morning. So I've just kind of rattled that off. I can see there's a lot of comments coming through. So I'll harvest all these. I'll get my scythe out in a minute and I'll take them over to the Padlet. And there's a lot of humor going on. Okay, so Let's let all those words land, and let's explore the metta bhavana. So yeah, take up your take up whatever posture is best for you. So let's see what's present now. So we'll have a 20 minute period of meditation now. Getting a sense of the support beneath you. So this grounding can be felt on a very primal level, this sense of solid ground. And maybe just given that input, we can just do a little exercise around safety. So, like just to spend a minute here on the senses. So just invite you now to sense listening. Can you hear anything that is threatening in your environment? And then if you've got your eyes closed, the invitation is just very gently open them and just to really take in the space you're in. And the invitation here is, can you see anything that's threatening? Really allowing our being just to really take in the present moment here. That we are actually here now. This is our world now. And then the next invitation, can you smell any dangerous smells? Can you smell burning or toxic fumes? Anything that smells like it could imply danger? So here we are practicing. Sensitive to our whole body and the support of what's beneath. And in the first stage, of the flowing life of our six senses. It's a dynamic, fluid realm of experiencing. The intention to allow this spontaneous manifesting in the warm, open, welcome space of awareness. And now evoking a sense of a good friend. How is it to hold the sense of a good friend? As we now practice openness and sensitivity to holding in mind someone we find more neutral in response. And that evoking a sense of someone we can find difficult. How is it to hold in mind and body the sense of someone you can find difficult? Holding with a sense of wishing them well. How is that? Now bringing to heart and mind people from previous stages and ourselves. Gradually extending that sense of love and metta, ever widening circles. May all beings be well. And find the great peace. And in a minute, I'll ring the bell and you may wish to carry on meditating. And we'll take a 15-minute break till 5 past the hour.
Hello, welcome back. Thank you so much, Balajit. I love hearing you talk about the inner child. Something in me just feels so deeply grateful to your own, like your journey, and how much you share, how generously you share with us. And yeah, there's something about that. I'll just say this. I'm noticing on this retreat, there's like, for me, there's something about sort of like wanting to speak my truth and also take care of how I use my words. And sometimes, historically, I've sometimes spoken my truth and not been as careful about how I use my words. So appreciating how that lands. But I do have to just honestly say that there's something about particularly like how you, and you've named this on this retreat already, like your embodiment. So you are a white male. And like, there is something for me quite healing about a white male speaking so openly and tenderly about the inner child that I think like, oh, wow, this is how we change the world. You know, and that's not to say that, like, you know, all white men are responsible for how fucked up the world is. Excuse my French. But I just have to say, like, you know, this morning, I wasn't sure if I was going to share this or not, but I'll just share it because it's here. I read a news article this morning about Tucker Carlson, the right-wing American newscaster, in quotes. Who just got fired recently from Fox News. And it's gotta be pretty bad when Fox News fires you. But I have to say, I felt compassion. I really felt compassion for Tucker Carlson. And the reason why is because the article was about how part of what led to his dismissal was him waking up to how harmful his views were. Yeah. So I won't say more about that, but if you're curious, you can go and look for that article. It was specifically revealing, I think it was a New York Times article revealing some of the text messages, the last text messages that he'd sent to producers. And this kind of voice inside his head, like cautioning him to not keep going towards the hatred that was building up in him, in his own heart. So so change is possible. And I thought we'd just spend the second half of this morning. I'm going to just say a little bit. I'm not going to talk for too long because I'd like to leave time for meditation. But I thought I'd just talk more personally about how allowing ourselves to really feel pleasure and joy, like really, totally, fully, completely allow sensations that have the taste of freedom, as the Buddha said, is a radical act. It's a radical act. And how we can resource ourselves, we can learn how to resource ourselves with sensations that have the taste of freedom. We can learn to build confidence in our capacity to do that in a way that is not dependent on external stimuli. And how that is a direct affront to our consumerist culture, our world that's so driven by the powers of greed, hatred, and delusion, to actually both allow ourselves to feel pleasure and joy and trust in our capacity to do that, to rest in that, to resource ourselves with those sensations is radical, deeply radical. So if you worry that you're not doing enough to meet the challenges of our current situation as a global community, I want to invite you to appreciate that just being here is, you're doing that. Yeah, we're all participating in a momentum towards greater awakening, compassion, and that can't not have an effect. Even if we never know what that effect is. So I want to link back to a couple of things we touched upon earlier in the retreat. So I think I mentioned about my own journey with metta and not being able to really contact self metta at all when I was first introduced to the practice. So I want to tell the end of, well, it's not the end. I want to tell the next chapter of that story, which is that in going more deeply into my own practice and experience of what was emerging in the mindfulness of breathing, I sort of found the trapdoor into metta, quite surprisingly. And it was through particularly practicing anapanasati. So I think this was already mentioned on the retreat. So this is the sutta translates, anapanasati translates as mindfulness of in and out breathing. And it's a beautiful, it's like the Buddha's most pith teachings on how the breath can open us to the fullness of life and to the truth body, and back to that language. And it's, the sutta is organized into 16 lines that are also, that are further organized into four buckets of four. So they're called tetrads. And in the second tetrad, the Buddha points to how by turning towards and dwelling in pleasant vedana, so pleasant sensations in the body, we can learn to open more and more fully to all of experience. So the subtlety of, it can be quite subtle, the subtlety of even just the beginnings of something that feels a little bit more open, a little bit more spacious, a little bit more at peace, a little bit more expansive, a little bit more freeing, supports us to open to the subtlety of the fullness, the full range of that beautiful rainbow of emotions. So when Viveka was talking about, you know, like part of practice supports us to notice anger before it becomes full-blown hatred, yeah? To notice even just the beginnings of a little bit of a rub in an interaction with someone. So there's a dynamic here where if we can do that with the pleasant and allow ourselves to stay with that and enjoy that and dwell in that, then also subtle sensations that maybe are a sign that a boundary is being crossed, or we're edging into what's not known to us yet. There's maybe a little bit of confusion, or we're just slightly dissatisfied with the moment. And normally how we'd follow that through is reaching for the phone or the Netflix or the cake or the alcohol or the cigarettes or whatever. So when I first started practicing, the only time I felt anything was when I was either having sex, getting drunk, or listening to music. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, right? And that's not really a sustainable way to live. Although those things can bring pleasure, when we go back to the teachings on indulgence, they're not going to help us wake up, right? They might be helpful resources when we do get to the edge of our window of tolerance. Maybe it can be skillful, actually, to just pause. And like sometimes I will like purposely choose to watch a TV show to just like give that part of me that needs to sort of just unwind and dissociate for a while, a bit of relief. Yeah, I think even Bhante said like a glass of wine at dinner can help loosen people up. So I'm not saying there's anything inherently wrong with those things, and we know for many of us, and I have a lot of friends in the AA community, for example, you know, it can lead to a lot of pain and unskillfulness. And so we do the best we can to work with that. So I was also like, you know, really interested when I was first starting to practice how I could overcome these addictions, these ways of kind of trying to soothe and find healthier ways to self-soothe, as it were. And so just doing lots of mindfulness of breathing and beginning to open to the subtlety of pleasant sensations in the body, and then framing that for myself as a way of loving myself. So my practice of self-love became giving myself the gift of, when there was something pleasant happening, really turning towards it and dwelling in it and letting myself fully have and enjoy that experience. So I thought I would lead us in a practice where we can explore this a little bit. And I just wanna say before we go into this practice that, you know, a lot of us here on the retreat have been practicing for a long time, and that's great. And what that inevitably means is we probably have a relationship to this material, and it could be problematic, that relationship. So I've worked with people who, you know, started coming along to Tiratna, started to have, let's just use the word dhyanic experience. So dhyana as more open, expansive states, tried to talk about them and were told that's not important, don't pay attention to that. Or even that's not skillful, to let yourself have that experience, and shut it down. It's so sad. It breaks my heart. You know, that's not, I don't blame anyone for that. It's just like, in a way, it's kind of understandable that if you haven't had those experiences, it might be uncomfortable for you to be hearing that someone else is having that experience. So, or it might be that you've heard people talk about this and then it eludes you, like you don't know what they're talking about. You've never had those experiences. So there's doubt there about whether or not you also can or are deserving of these experiences. Or maybe you yourself think, oh, that's danger. That's a dangerous territory. If I start opening to pleasure in my body, I'll get really intoxicated, and then I'll want that all the time, and it'll completely ruin my meditation. I won't be able to be present to anything if that's not what's happening. So there can be a lot of charged emotion around this material. So what I want to invite us to do is to first just acknowledge if that's happening for you, and appreciate the tension there, if there is any tension. And then just for this session, so like for the next, where are we, 40 minutes, maybe just hold those parts a little bit more provisionally, if that's possible, and just see what might happen. Let's see what might happen today within the context and conditions of this retreat. So I won't give any more dharmic input on this, because I'm aware of time and I want to get into practice. And there's plenty of resources, particularly actually on my website. There's a lot of talks and led practices in this area. So if you wanted to go and look and see, like get more of the dharmic input, particularly around the dhyana factors and how to cultivate them, you can go there. But also the way I'm going to lead this practice will follow that. That sequence quite faithfully. Okay, so hope that's all right. If we can move on to meditation. So setting yourself up in a way that feels supportive just now, noticing what the body needs and maybe giving it what it needs. Lying down is always an option. And we're going to be meditating for about 30 minutes, and then we'll have a bit of space at the end for inquiry. Get curious together about anything you notice there. So feel free to join me with a few deep breaths if that's comfortable, just to settle into the posture. Making any noises that feel good to you on the out breath. You could even do the shushing that we did earlier on the retreat if you like. letting all the words fall away. Don't have to remember anything. Don't have to do anything. Don't have to be any special way right now. Just as you are is enough. Allowing the breath to return to its natural rhythm. And on the next in-breath, just dropping the awareness right down into those points of contact with the ground. Spend a few minutes here exploring sensations arising and passing, where the body meets the earth. Then aware of the upper body rising into space towards the sky. If you're laying down, the whole of the front of the body opening to space. So ground and space as resources that we can always return to in the practice, no matter what's happening. And with the in-breath, just noticing how the body naturally softens and expands into space. Breathing in spaciousness, breathing out stillness, releasing into the stillness of the ground. And then as you feel ready, there's an invitation to begin to direct awareness to the breath, or maybe awareness is just arising. The breath is simply arising in awareness. So just noticing that the breath is here and can be known and attended to directly as sensation. We'll spend a few minutes here just getting curious about how it is. How is this breath just now? But there's an invitation now. If you'd like to just begin to broaden the awareness to include the whole body breathing, all the sensations coming and going from the deepest part of you all the way out to the edges and beyond. And in this broad open awareness, we're just going to start noticing if there's any sensations here that have the taste of freedom. So anything as subtle as a gentle tingling right on the tip of the pinky finger to a sense of openness, softness in the belly, expansiveness in the heart center, warmth in the legs, anything that feels good, juicy, pleasant, yummy. Bubbling up somewhere. Movement of energy. And if you're in touch with anything like that, then the invitation is to really drop the awareness right into those sensations, attending to them lovingly. Becoming absorbed in them, allowing them to move and change in any way they want to. Appreciating and even letting yourself enjoy what's here for as long as it's here. Could even be as subtle as the absence of pain in a place where you sometimes feel pain. What's that like? Just going to notice here how much effort is needed. So if there's a sense that you're sort of clamping down on something, getting a bit rigid or cold, or trying to crowbar something open, just want to invite you to practice the flashing into open awareness that we played around with yesterday. Viveka invited us to see what it was like to flash into open awareness, into openness. Or you might even bring a little movement in, give the body a little jiggle. Deeper breath, reconnection with the ground, with space. If you feel like you've gotten a bit soupy or vague or foggy or lost the thread with distraction, you can always come back to the breath as an anchor. There might be some sensations here that we can begin to notice as pleasant, dwelling and appreciating those. Gently tending. Sensations of freedom. It may be that as we attend to these pleasurable sensations, we also start to become aware of a deeper sense of ease or calm, contentment, peace, okayness, something a bit quieter, but also a bit more integrated in our being. If you have any sense of this, then the invitation at this point in the practice is to begin to turn towards that feeling or community of feelings. It could just be a very simple sense of being well just now. perhaps despite pain or mental distress, a wellness is also here. And we'll just hang out with that sensation for a little while if that's what's going on for you. And if it's not, just staying with pleasurable feelings or the breath, whatever is supporting you best just now. Just want to invite you to notice the quality of the mind right now. And particularly if there's any sense of stillness, stability, quiet, expansion, clarity, sensitivity. How is this awareness? It may be that thoughts continue to come and go, but maybe they're a little bit less sticky than usual. Don't draw us in as easily. bit more perspective. So for the last few minutes here, we're just going to familiarize ourselves with the qualities of the heart-mind just now. How is it? What's possible now? Be ringing a bell, which is an opportunity to begin to move the body in any way that feels good to you as we emerge from the practice. And also a chance to reflect on anything you've noticed there, anything at all. And feeling free to drop that into the chat if you'd like. Making any sounds that feel good to you as well. We've got a bit of time just to explore what we noticed there. And these short periods of inquiry after a practice really are in service of the whole group. So if you offer something. Yeah, others benefit from that. They benefit from hearing from you as much as you benefit from being heard. So do feel free to drop anything in the chat that you notice there. So Sue, hi Sue. Had a new relationship with the breath for the first time. And deep rush of energy through the heart, chest, and down the arms and hands. Beautiful. Oh, thanks, Sue. Appreciate hearing about that experience from you. So yeah, I just encourage you to maybe give yourself a little bit of space after the session today to really let yourself absorb the fullness of what happened there, especially because it was a new experience. So really giving yourself the space to allow that experience to sort of fully move through you and enjoy it. Bugs. Again, how fundamental to my practice the anapanasati and navigating the negativity bias is. Oh, yeah. So, yes, that's right. Thank you for bringing in the negativity bias. So I'll just say something about this for folks who might not be familiar with the concept. This is our inbuilt mechanism from the earliest part of the brain that's designed to keep us safe. Which is great. So we're, you know, hardwired to be constantly on the lookout for threat, and it can bias us away from pleasurable experience. So our ancestors, you know, stopping and taking in a beautiful flower wasn't going to save them if a lion was chasing them. So yeah, we have to sort of rewire the brain, habituate towards pleasant experience. So thanks for bringing in that concept, folks. Sarah, some delicious softness. Oh, that's nice. Delicious softness. Rovi, a very tender encounter between inner child, inner teenager, and the presence of a wiser self. And in capital letters, the lungs embracing the heart. Ooh, I like that. Lungs embracing the heart. Hmm. Yeah. Thank you. Rachel, lovely sense of peace and ease. Really enjoyed settling into it after a while. A sense of this ease joining up with heartache and tightness. Yeah, thanks for that, Rachel. Yeah. I appreciate you saying that because, yeah, I think one possibly unhelpful view that can come out of practicing in this way is that then we think it's all about that and we just have to get to those pleasurable sensations. So that's not what's being taught here. So we're introducing this as a resource that supports us actually to build our window of tolerance, build our resilience so we can be with the more challenging, difficult emotions for longer and open the broadness to more of a range. And I just noticed when I said for longer that I wanted to correct myself. So longer, not so that then we have to stay with it forever, but to appreciate from the view. So yesterday we talked about, you know, starting with the wisdom perspective, that ultimately everything is impermanent. So can we also trust that when we open to heartache and tenderness, that also moves through us? It's not a permanent state. It's not, it doesn't have to overwhelm us if we can learn to navigate it by resourcing ourselves in other ways. So many of you will know I worked for Breathworks for a number of years, and there's a few of you here actually have trained with Breathworks. So you'll know that there's this concept of the bigger container, you know, holding both the pleasant and the unpleasant in a bigger container. So thank you, Rachel, for modeling that. That's part of what we're working towards, is to be able to be big enough that we can hold it all, even at the same time, like simultaneity of both pleasant and unpleasant. Chandra Nishta, tender bubbling light feeling in chest, like soap bubbles in the sun. Yeah, I get that too. Yeah, the soap bubbles, sort of something kind of shimmering there, and both the emptiness and form of bubbles. Yeah. Frank, quite an intense sit, a mix of seemingly contradicting things going on. Yes. Tension and softness in the body at the same time. A lot of physical stillness, lots of pleasure, a lot of mental distraction, yeah. Almost no resting on the breath, yeah. And when it did rest, it quickly bounced off into some thought stream. One of those sits where I was wondering if I was indeed meditating at all. It's funny that that's what you wrote, because I was literally thinking just before I read that sentence, sounds like you were meditating. There's so much noticing going on. There's so much awareness of what was happening. Yeah. Wanted to get up off the cushion. Yeah. Yeah. So that's the part. And that's a really good example of the threat response to something that we don't want to be happening. Yeah. So that the flight response. If I hadn't been sitting with you all, i.e., if I was on my own, I may not have kept going.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Go well.